Attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, this is Brad Adams. I am the website chair for the Tennessee chapter of HFMA, and I will be your host for today's webinar. Before we get going and I turn it over to Paul Kim, our speaker, I want to cover a couple of quick housekeeping items. First thing is, for today's webinar, if you need to get a continuing education certificate, there are a couple requirements that we have. One is that you are connected, for at least 90% of the time of the webinar. And the second one is that you respond to the polling questions that will be presented throughout the webinar. So we will be bringing those up periodically. So when you hear us bring up a polling question, please make sure that you respond to that. Respond to it, period, but definitely if you need continuing education credits, you need to respond to the polling questions. So we've got a couple of events coming up. At the end of this month, March is a pretty busy for Tennessee chapter of HFMA. So in addition to our webinar today, we've also got a series of webinars that began last week. For those of you who might be interested in getting your certified healthcare financial professional certification, we've got three or four slots left for that. So if you're interested in that, you can visit the website. If you are in the Knoxville, East Tennessee area, we've got a joint meeting tomorrow evening with East Tennessee Healthcare Executive Association, and they're going to be discussing future of healthcare finance. More information about that, once again, on the website. And that is going to be at Calhoun's on the river in Knoxville. And then beginning next week, we start the payer summits over the next 2 weeks. So starting on the 18th in Memphis, 19th in Nashville, 25th in Chattanooga, 26th in Knoxville, and 27th in Tri-Cities. So once again, all that information is available up on our website at tnhfma.org. And I will probably get beaten if I do not remind you that the Spring Institute is coming up in May. That's going to be May 18th through the 21st. And you can find out more information about the Spring Institute at thespringinstitute.org. So without further ado, I want to introduce our speaker today. Paul Kim is a principal with the Healthcare Law Group with Oberkoller, and I probably just mispronounced that, and Paul will correct me here in a minute. But Paul works with a lot of healthcare clients, healthcare law, everything from corporate compliance to reimbursement litigation. And today, Paul is going to speak with us about all of the different audits that we've got going on in the appeals process for the RACs and dealing with administrative law judges, all of that fun stuff we all enjoy, probably the favorite part of all of our jobs, Medicare appeals. So Paul, I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to you.
Thank you very much. Good morning and good afternoon. As mentioned, I will be discussing, in essence, the outline of a Medicare claims appeal. Regardless of which entity actually audited your organization or your client's claim, whether it's the Office of Inspector General, whether it's the local Medicare administrative contractor, or whether it's a Zone Program Integrity Contractor, a ZPIC, or as you may have already experienced already, whether it's a recovery audit contractor, a RAC, the appeal process for these overpayment assessments is the same. Okay. So it is only applicable to claims, so any cost report filed by certified providers are not subject to this process, and that those appeals are still handled and reviewed by the PRRB, the Provider Reimbursement Review Board. I hope everyone can hear me. I hear a lot of typing and discussion, but this particular process is applicable to both Part A and B, but only claims again. So it could be hospital inpatient claims, it could be physician outpatient claims, it can be durable medical equipment claims. either way, this process was finalized by CMS. I'm sorry, I still hear a lot of background noise. Hopefully everyone can hear me okay.
Yeah, well, you should be the only one who's unmuted right now, so hopefully that'll just kind of resolve itself
okay.
in a moment.
Alrighty. So, it was issued as an interim final rule in 2005, and it took 5 years for CMS to finalize this without any significant changes. But nevertheless, this is the final process that are available to any Medicare provider, Part A provider, or Part B supplier that has been subject to an audit by an OIG, by the OIG, a RAC, the local MAC, the ZPIC, and assessed an overpayment. At this time, I would like to ask a polling question, please.
Let me bring that up for you. All right, so remember we need you guys to answer these for you to get your CPE certificates. So the first question is, has your organization been subject to any Medicare audits in the past 5 years? So, yes, no, I don't know, or I don't work for a provider organization. So for those of you guys who don't work actually at a hospital, medical center, private physician practice, that type of thing. So we're going to leave voting up just for those of you who haven't had a chance to for another 20 seconds or so. But Paul, pretty much we have got, you know, of those who have voted, about 20%, this doesn't apply to them, about 10% aren't sure, about 13% have not had been subject to an audit, and about 58% of the folks on here have been subject to a Medicare audit.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, for those of you who have not been subject to an audit or are not sure, congratulations. Unfortunately, as CMS, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, the Medicare agency, the federal agency, continues to deploy an army, an alphabet of auditors, it's very rare to actually encounter a Medicare provider supplier that has not been subject to an audit by any one of these auditors. So unfortunately, it has for many, and it will for all of you, become a routine cost of doing business with Medicare. So hopefully this seminar, this webinar will help you address those auditors and be successful. Because at the end of the day, for the RAC audits anyway, CMS recently released stats showing that about two-thirds of the appeals have been successful. Now I'll go into more detail about at what level that may have occurred, but nevertheless, you can clearly see that unless you exert your appeals rights, you will not be successful. Okay. Now, there is a separate step that is sometimes earlier on, but also sometimes at parallel tracks, and that's called a rebuttal or a discussion period. Many folks complain to Congress that had they just had an opportunity to discuss with the auditor, to show the auditor that there were certain pages missing in a record, that they did not consider certain other documentation, that they could have avoided the appeals process and the and had not been subject to the overpayment at all. So Congress specifically added a statutory provision that allows any Medicare provider or supplier that was subjected to an audit to be able to submit written rebuttal directly to the auditor. Okay. The provider or supplier had up to 15 days to do so, but unfortunately, this was a horrible waste of time and money. For example, in one case, we submitted over 250 pages of documents, some new documents, and the delivery tracking showed that the auditor received it a little after 10 a.m. A couple of days later, we received a one-page, two-paragraph letter from the auditor, in essence thanking us, but affirming the overpayment that they've assessed previously. Now, just by chance, the auditor included, probably inadvertently, the tracking, courier tracking information on their letter. And so we were able to actually track that and see that they actually sent that out by 6 p.m. the exact same day. So in other words, they were able to review and analyze from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. over 250 pages of documents to conclude and to issue that two-paragraph, single-page letter. So that's just one example of how horrible the rebuttal process was. And very likely CMS became aware of this. And so when CMS finalized and made permanent the RAC program, instead of calling it the rebuttal, they began calling it the discussion period, okay? This is where literally someone who's been subject to a RAC audit can call the RAC and discuss and have a conversation with a representative to better understand the audit, but also to explain why the overpayment may be incorrect. In particular, there's a physician-to-physician one-on-one opportunity, which you know has to be scheduled in advance, but nevertheless available through each of the four regional RACs. They each have a website, and details are available on their website. And the timeline also differs, sometimes up to 15 days, sometimes up to 30 days. But you can actually schedule a one-on-one. So a physician from your organization can speak with a medical director from the local RAC and have a conversation. And to my skeptical surprise, I've been hearing that the discussion period for the RACs have been tremendously successful. So I do encourage you to take the time to actually pursue this. But know that this is an actual process that is not part of the formal appeal process that we'll be discussing today. This is a separate process, and so you need to keep tabs of any timelines and deadlines that may come up from the actual formal appeal process. So this is just an adjunct process, but for RACs anyway, it's been tremendously successful, so you should consider including this process in addition to the formal process. Now, the first official formal process is called a redetermination. And this is where you would file a written request for redetermination of an overpayment assessment to your local MAC, your Medicare Administrative Contractor, whether it's Part B or Part A. Technically, you have 120 days to request this, and that's 120 days from the date you receive the demand letter, the letter demanding the refund of those overpayments. But quite frankly, I highly encourage everyone here to count the 120 days from the actual date of the demand notice. You'd be surprised how quickly even 120 days goes by, and so therefore, do keep track of the 120 days from the date of the notice requesting the money back rather than the actual date that you received that notice. Technically, Medicare recognizes 5 days for delivery, so technically you have a maximum of 125 days from the date of the notice, but again, to be conservative, and to make sure that your appeal is not dismissed for being untimely, again, recommend that you count the days from the date of the actual demand notice. Now, however, if for some reason, let's say mail got lost or there was a change of address during this time period, you did not receive the decision in time, and therefore you are too late to make this request. I'm sorry, the demand letter in time. And so therefore you're too late to make this request for redetermination, you can try to still appeal and show good cause. The Medicare regulations do allow for this, and so if you can document, lost mail or delayed mail because of change of address or any other similar facts, you can request a late appeal and still have that appeal accepted. Now, once you file the appeal, technically the MAC has 60 days from the date they received your appeal to issue a written decision, okay? Now, unfortunately, because of the tremendous number of RAC and ZPIC audits, the most MACs have not been very timely in issuing its written decision. And there's unfortunately very little recourse. Technically, they're supposed to look at the file, look at the records, look at the claim documents, and issue a brand new, a de novo decision. And perhaps that's the reason why they're being delayed. But nevertheless, just more recently, many of the MACs have not been able to issue written decisions within 60 days. So be aware of it, and we'll talk about some tips to make sure we keep tabs on those requests. Now, the first level appeal does require specific data elements. You'll see on this slide the patient's name, HIC number, DOS, as well as an actual signature. There are forms for this, all available on the CMS website. It's a one-page, double-sided document. In fact, for every of the first four appeal levels that we'll be discussing today, I want to note that there is a template form available from CMS on its website, and it's very user-friendly. Why? Because not only do the providers and suppliers have these appeal rights, but so do the beneficiaries themselves, so do the patients themselves. So to make it easier for those individuals, CMS has made filing an appeal very simple. Nevertheless, you must make sure that all of the required elements are included. Otherwise, you will not have perfected your appeal, and therefore, whoever is reviewing that appeal will actually have the legal right to dismiss your appeal. So make sure that you have all these elements included. Now, you are not required to have outside consultants or lawyers handle your appeal, but should you decide to pursue that, there's also a form for that as well. And you need to make sure that a form is filled out, signed by you as well as your representative, and filed with your appeal so that your local MAC can conclude that this individual is indeed an authorized appointed representative for you, the appellant. The second official level of the Medicare claims appeal process is called a reconsideration. You request reconsiderations from one of nine qualified independent contractors. There are several for Part A, Part B, East, West, North, South, DME, and so forth. So a particular local corresponding QIC name and address will be included in your redetermination decision from your local MAC. And should that decision be unfavorable, you have 180 days to request a reconsideration, the second level appeal. Same comments as I made about keeping track of deadlines apply here. The QIC has, similar to the MAC, has 60 days to issue a written decision. They too have been delayed, but unlike with the first level appeal, the Medicare regulations actually allow you to escalate to the next level, to the third level, should the QIC decision be delayed. Now, quite frankly, I don't find this very helpful, because the QIC does address other issues more so than the MAC in the redetermination decision. Typically, the MACs will just decide a case based on medical necessity, typically. However, the QIC may actually consider other issues, such as coding issues, if there are some statistical sampling and extrapolation involved, those types of non-clinical issues as well. So you'll find that despite the delay, it might be helpful to pursue and wait for a reconsideration decision as well. Like the Macs, the Quicks are making these decisions from scratch. They're not bound by the redetermination decision. They're not even bound by whatever founding that the auditor has included in its overpayment assessment. So it's a brand new, you know, from the scratch decision. Now, however, you actually have an opportunity to submit new evidence at this time. In fact, there's a requirement that all documentary evidence that you want the reviewer to consider, all documentary evidence must be submitted no later than at this level, okay? So you may have missed, you may have not submitted certain documents to the MAC for your first level appeal, but for the second level appeal, you must submit them. Otherwise, unless there is good cause, it will, none of those documents will be considered in future proceedings. Like the first level appeal, there are certain elements that are required to perfect the appeal, very similar to the first level appeal. The only difference here is really that because the Quicks deal with more than one MAC, you do need to name the MAC that issued the redetermination decision so that the Quick can obtain the entire file from the appropriate MAC. And at this time, I want to ask the second polling question, please.
Okay. Thank you, Paul. All right. So our next polling question, don't forget you need to vote to get your CPE. If your organization has been audited but did not file appeals, please explain the reasons. So on this one, it's checkboxes. So if you have more than one reason, go ahead and check those off before you hit submit. So the choices are the auditor was correct, cost-benefit analysis showed it wasn't worth the expense of the appeal, you did not want to attract any additional attention, you were unaware of how to appeal, or this just doesn't apply to you. So leave that open for about 20, 25 more seconds. We've got about half the folks have voted so far, still coming in. So we have got, well, a good portion of them, you know, it's about half and half, applies, doesn't apply. But for the ones that it does apply, you know, the majority of those, the auditor was correct in their determination.
So. Thank you very much. You know, especially with the RACs, I've been finding more and more clients have concluded that indeed the auditor was correct, most likely because the RACs payments are contingent on a successful defense of their assessment, they're probably being more cautious. But you know, with the other auditors, that generally has not been the case. So I suspect that for those of you who responded that the auditor was correct, most likely we're talking about RACs than other auditors. But we'll continue here. Oh boy. Okay. Sorry, I don't know why. Okay. So the third level is a request for an ALJ hearing, administrative law judge hearing. So if you have an unfavorable QIP decision, you have a right to an ALJ hearing. Now I gotta say, you will find that most of the time you will lose in the first two levels of the appeal, okay? The MACs almost always issue decisions affirming the auditor's decision, and the QIC, but for about 10 to 15% of the time, will also issue decisions affirming the redetermination decision. So you'll find that during the first two levels, you will not necessarily receive relief. However, because the first two levels involve submission of written appeals, I think you'll find that at the ALJ level, it's dramatically different. And in fact, when I mentioned earlier that CMS has issued stats stating that about two-thirds of the RAC appeals are reversed, that's typically at the third level, the ALJ level, okay? Now, There are four field offices, Irvine, California, Miami, Florida, Cleveland, Ohio, and Arlington, Virginia. And prior to 2012, you were required to file this appeal with your local hearings office. However, because of tremendous backlogs, and we'll go into more detail in a bit, now everyone is required to file your ALJ hearing request with the Cleveland office, and in turn, the Cleveland office is supposed to evenly distribute the appeals to different ALJs among all four field offices, okay? The time is a little shorter. You now only have 60 days to file this third level appeal. You have several choices. You can ask for an in-person hearing at the local, at the hearings office. It used to be local, now it could be one of four field offices. However, you need to actually show good cause. So typically, you may not be granted a request for an in-person hearing. Another option of the format is a video hearing. This is fairly common, although I have to say some ALJs, because of some cost concerns, have been declining such requests. What happens is if you don't have video capability already, they will assign you to a commercial location like Kinko's. And obviously there's cost associated with that. And so that's why some of the ALJs have been reluctant to even grant a video hearing. Now you may think that you have Skype and everything else, but unfortunately, because there are beneficiaries involved and HIPAA concerns, the hearings office will only assign you to a commercial HIPAA-compliant video center. Now by far, majority of the hearings are assigned a telephone format. And this is where the ALJ can call you, or the ALJ gives you a dial-in number to call, and everything's conducted by phone. And of course, the final format is similar to the first two levels, and that's on the record. It's very similar, and you basically would file the appeal and write in why you disagree with the QIC and their rationale, and more importantly, why your claims should be paid. Again, this is a de novo process, de novo review process, so the ALJs are not necessarily bound by anything that was previously noted or found, and so you do still need to show, regardless of what the QIC may or may not have said, why your claim is fully compliant and should be reimbursed. Now, the ALJs technically, per regulation, have 90 days from the date they receive your appeal to schedule a hearing, to conduct a hearing, and to issue a written decision, okay? That has not occurred for about at least 2 years, unfortunately. Even though the 90-day doesn't apply for in-person hearings, typically because of the delay, the ALJs would request a waiver, and so you would actually sign a document waiving your right to a 90-day decision. Now, many clients ask, well, listen, you know, I don't want the money to be recouped. The money has already been recouped. We need the cash flow. I don't want to do this. But pardon my attorney, I don't know why you'd want to piss off an ALJ from the beginning. So almost always I recommend that should an ALJ be delayed and request a waiver to be signed, that you do sign that. Again, 2 years ago, that was not a tremendous problem because even though you signed the waiver, a hearing was usually scheduled in 3 or 4 months, and then after a hearing was actually held, you received the written decision in about another month anyway. So it was not a tremendous delay, but nevertheless, they would ask those waivers. Very similar to the QIC level, you do have a right to escalation to the next level. But because you'll see that the next level is more of a review process rather than a hearing process, you'll find that there's a benefit of actually having a hearing, having an audio tape or a transcript of the hearing so that the fourth level reviewer can actually benefit from that information. So typically I do not recommend that that your appeal be escalated. This has come up more often because of recent delays, which I'll discuss further in a bit. You do need to include the required elements so that your appeal is not dismissed, kicked out. There are some differences. For example, you do need to explain why you disagree specifically with the QIC. If by chance you still did not get to submit some documentary evidence to the QIC, you have an opportunity to try to submit that here, but you do need to show good cause, and generally ALJs are not very understanding. Now, some new issues regarding this third level appeal step. First of all, every claim must the amount involved in every claim must be at least $140. Now, you can aggregate claims if they're similar. So for example, if you have $500 claims for the same issue, for same CPT code, for example, you can actually aggregate those claims to meet this $140 threshold if each claim does not meet it. Nevertheless, you still need to meet this. So obviously, if you have $5, $10 claims, you will not be able to pursue this third level appeal. You need to also make a statement indicating that you have sent a copy of your appeal to all parties. Now, some ALJs will actually kick your appeal out if you did not do this. All parties include beneficiaries, okay? So you need to send a copy of your appeal to each of the beneficiaries of the claims that you're appealing, okay? And for HIPAA purposes, you need to make sure that your appeal letter does not include any PHI and that there's no other document that lists any patient, even the certificate of service. Okay, so you need to be very cautious about this step, because in trying to comply with this requirement, you want to make sure that you don't you're also compliant with the HIPAA requirements as well. Be aware that sometimes the ALJs might actually retain their own independent clinical expert. Okay, not surprising, these ALJs are lay folks like me; they're not clinicians, and so it's not surprising that they may actually try to retain independent experts. Not always, but be aware that they do have a right to do that. In additionally, be also aware that either CMS or their contractors may submit their intent to participate in these hearings. Okay, typically it's the RAC that will want to participate. If it's a ZPIC, it will participate only if there was statistical sampling involved, and I'll again talk about more on that later. But they do need to make sure that they meet requirements like providing 10 days advance notice. Sometimes the ALJs request them. You know, if it involves a particular policy and the interpretation of that policy, the ALJs may request that CMS or the contractor be involved to answer that specific question, to address that specific issue. Typically, it's a limited role. Now, sometimes the CMS or its contractors may try to come in as a party. What that means is if you're a party, you have a right to present testimony, you have a right to cross-examine other witnesses. Generally, the ALJs do not permit this. It's certainly prohibited by regulation if the appellant is only a beneficiary who does not have a representative. But nevertheless, even if you see a contractor like the RAC state that they want to participate as a party, typically the ALJs do not allow this, and instead just allow that representative from the contractor to make a statement during the hearing. So there are a lot of different issues that come up in this third level appeal, but it is in essence an official but informal hearing. You know, the rules of evidence are relaxed. Maybe you can compare it to people's court, but it is an official process, but just informal. Now, before I continue, I'd like to ask the third polling question at this time, please.
All right, let me bring that up. Okay, so our third question is, has your organization appealed through only the first two levels? So the response options here are yes, only the first two levels, no, more than the first two levels, I don't know or this does not apply to me. So while we're waiting for folks to go ahead and submit their answers, we will have time at the end of this for a short Q&A with Paul. So if you've got questions, you can go ahead and submit those in through the questions box on your GoToWebinar control panel there. And just remind everybody, Paul's answers do not represent legal advice. And so that if you've got, detailed questions or things like that, always make sure you have your own legal representation to review and advise you. Did I get that right, Paul?
Thank you.
All right. We'll give it just another couple seconds, folks. Remember, you need to respond if you want to get your CPE certificate. But of everybody who's responded, we have 17% of the folks who said they have only done the first two levels, but 48 who say they've gone beyond that second level.
Thank you very much. I like to think that those of you who only went to the first two levels is because you were successful. Most likely that's not the case, and it's unfortunately true that that's not the case. In the past, certainly before August of last year, you didn't really get a true appeal, a true form, a fair shake, until and unless you came to the third level, okay? And so for those folks who decided, you know what, I'm just going to try out the first level and see what happens, or I'm going to just try out the first two levels to see what happens, because typically it's easier and less costly. You're just submitting something in writing, okay? If that was the case, unfortunately, I have to say it was probably not very fruitful. So I think you need to make a decision in terms of a denial or an overpayment assessment. Am I willing to go to at least a third level with this claim? Because that's the only way you can truly get an appeal under a form that is fair, where you feel that they've heard everything you have to say. Because if you just do it for the first two levels, you might as well, quite frankly, not even start it at all. Now, here's the sad fact about that issue, however. Sorry. Just last month, the hearings office issued memos and actually held an all-day town hall meeting announcing a two-year suspension of scheduling hearings for new appeals. Okay, so typically anything that's filed on or after July 2013, although during this session they mentioned April 2013 as well, but I don't know if that's uniform, because I actually received some notices of hearing for appeals filed before July of 2013. So July, I think, is a fairly uniform number. Not all ALJs are required to do this, but in essence, they've allowed ALJs to not schedule any hearings for any appeals that were received by them on or after July 2013. Okay, that means anytime you file something today, you will not get a notice of hearing for at least 2 years, okay? So even though this is the best opportunity of your success, unfortunately, just recently, a tremendous wrench has been thrown into this. Now, maybe the bright light at the end of the tunnel is that some of the older appeals that were still on, behind the backlog will start to be scheduled. You know, I've seen that already for some of the early 2013 and late 2012 appeals, okay? Clearly these are beyond the 90 days, right? But I've seen older appeals finally get adjudicated or scheduled. But in terms of new appeals, this is tremendous. I'll also go into detail later, but by the time you actually wait for a hearing, most likely your local MAC will have fully recouped the alleged overpayment, okay? Under the old process, or rather the formal process and the regulation of 90 days, typically, if you get a decision in 90 days from an ALJ and it's successful, you are actually not subject to significant recruitment at all. But because you're not even getting a hearing date until a year or more later, most likely the amount that's allegedly overpaid to you will be recouped by the MAC. That's the bigger problem, okay? And you may have already heard that as a result of hearings office's decision, even CMS has in essence stopped post-pay RAC audits and prepay MAC reviews. I suspect that this is not just a showdown with CMS, but also a cry for help to HHS and Congress for additional resources. Especially from the ALJ's perspective, in my opinion, especially if what they're seeing is two-third reversal rate. So they believe that these RAC decisions, at least, should not have been denounced to begin with, and they're reversing two-thirds of them. So anyway, all of these combined, it's a very interesting time, but if even today you have a denial, do consider, please, whether or not you're willing to go to the third level, despite this delay, because otherwise the first two level will most likely be useless to you anyway, okay? The fourth level, should you actually receive a notice of hearing and have the hearing and receive a written ALJ decision that's unfavorable, you can file a request for review with the Medicare Appeals Council. This is not the MAC, the contractor, but an actual administrative appellate review body located in the offices of HHS in D.C. You have 60 days to make this request, and like the ALJs, the council has 90 days to issue a decision, but unfortunately, like the ALJs, they too have been tremendously delayed, okay? You do have a right to escalation, but that means you go to federal court. And again, you have a right to escalate to the council level from an ALJ hearing, but then you don't have the benefit of actually having a hearing, engaging in that intellectual discourse with the ALJ to try to convince the ALJ why the claim should be paid. Remember, you have a right to present testimony and have a discussion, and so if you just have the documents and you escalate to the council, it may not be as effective if there was an audio tape or a transcript of that testimony and discussion at the ALJ level. Now for the council, though, there is no hearing. They literally just review documents, listen to the audio tape of the hearing, or read the transcript of the hearing. You can ask permission to file briefs. It's not required, though. Likewise, you can ask permission to present oral arguments, similar to what you may see in Supreme Court, but it's also not required. Typically, the counsel will deny your request for oral arguments, but depending on the issue, grant your request for filing briefs. But again, because you've had a decision and a hearing at the third level, you generally will not need to do anything other than filing a written request for review and unfortunately waiting and waiting and waiting. The council can also receive appeals from CMS. Yes, so be aware, if you receive a favorable ALJ decision, either CMS can appeal that directly to the council, or another contractor of it, of CMS, administrative contractor, that basically scours through ALJ decisions, may also file an appeal, okay? Finally, the council on its own may decide to review an ALJ decision, okay? So be aware that even if you have a favorable ALJ decision, until the appeal deadline to the council has expired, the 60 days, your decision is not yet final. Obviously, if it's unfavorable, you have the right to appeal to the council. Generally, though, this doesn't occur very much. Generally, though, even if the council reverses the ALJ's decision and sends it back to the ALJs will issue a decision, unless it's absolutely incorrect, will issue a decision now that's, quite frankly, now that it's even stronger than before. So it's not usually a problem. Should this rare incidence occur on a favorable decision that you receive from an ALJ. What the council does look for, however, are as follows: abuse of any discretion or authority by the judge, any clear error of law, any other action or finding or conclusion that the evidence just does not support, and this is where CMS and its contractors might appeal if there are particular broad policy or procedural issues that it could affect the general public interest, including any other appeals that are in the pipeline. So council is limited in its scope in terms of accepting appeals, even from CMS or its contractors. But nevertheless, you know, please be aware that that this is, the fourth level is available to not just you who may have lost, but also the government that may have lost as well. The fifth and final level is an actual complaint that's filed with federal court. You basically follow your local U.S. District Court's rules, but you have 60 days to pursue this route. And for this year, the amount in controversy, the threshold level that we discussed earlier, is $1,430. So clearly, you'll need, you know, a claim must be a big ticket item, or you may need several claims to add and to aggregate to this particular threshold amount to even have this option available to you. Generally, federal court judges defer to the ALJs in terms of findings and facts, so you'll find that generally, you know, this is not a very helpful or beneficial level, and overall, among the five steps of the official Medicare claims appeal process, you'll find that the third level, the ALJ hearing, is truly your best shot, and anything beyond that, unless there's some procedural issues, in other words, non-factual, non-clinical issues, really, the fourth and fifth level may not be worth the wait or any potential new cost. Okay. You'll be surprised how often you might get documents from any of these levels that do not pertain to you or your patients. You'll be surprised how often your documents actually may not reach the appeals reviewer. So like in real estate, well, where location is the key, really here is documentation. Keep track of everything, keep copy of everything. Do spend that extra to receive some confirmation through a commercial courier, and also follow up. You know, you know that they're delayed, but if it's way beyond the 60 days, you need to at least document one follow-up so that no one else can argue that you're not diligent at all. So maybe the 90th day, maybe the 120th day, but at least once you may want to follow up and document that. So you can show that you diligently tried to follow up on any appeals or documents that you submitted. And the reviewer did not meet the 60 days in response. If you have a lot of claims that are similar, it may be cost effective to try to generate templates. I've been before all four field offices of ALJs, handled appeals from at all levels except for the discussion period, in doing so, you know, it's easier and more cost effective to create templates so that you can easily perfect the appeals and know that you haven't missed any required elements. One sample might you might want to consider is as follows: make sure that all the required elements for each level are included or at least solicited. Do try to actually have room to reiterate the specific allegations or rationale for the denial so that you can limit the scope or try to limit the scope of the appeal. Make sure that you understand and you outline all the Medicare requirements that are applicable to those claims. Do provide a short summary. Reams of documents involved potentially, and the key is, especially at the ALJ level, to humanize those documents, to for them, it's not a case, but really it could be their mother, it could be their grandfather, whatever. And so a clinical summary that talks about the patient may serve that purpose. And with the records, try to rebut to the extent possible each and all allegations from the auditor, from the MAC, from the QIC, to further show why the claims should be reimbursed. And in that effort, it will be very helpful to paginate whatever records that you ultimately send no later to than the second level to the QIC. I understand that now there are PDF programs that similar to a Xerox machine, will actually scan through but add a page number. I think that's a tremendous way to make sure that you can point out information in certain pages, and also in referencing certain pages at ALJ hearings or any of the written appeals, using page numbers makes it so much easier so that everyone is on the literally same page. Now, some of the auditors will not just deny a claim for medical necessity, but actually conduct statistical sampling and extrapolate the error rate through a universe of all similar claims. The OIG certainly does this. The ZPICs do this. In fact, my personal view, the ZPICs have been more active than the RACs. I have an article that says, I think the RACs bark, but the ZPICs bite, because I think they too want the lucrative contingency fee arrangement with CMS. Because almost every time a ZPIC is involved, there is statistical sampling and the overpayments are at least seven figures. The MACs, your local MACs, they used to use this more often. I'm seeing less and less of it, but they also have the authority to audit your claims based on sampling and extrapolation rather than just based on a non-random sample. Typically, through statistical sampling, they will select 20, 30, 60 claims, sometimes 100, depending on the type of provider or supplier you are, and audit those claims to come up with an error rate, let's say 20%, 30%. And then they will assess an overpayment by applying that error rate, 20%, let's say, to all of the claims, all of your claims, similar claims, going back 4 years, up to 4 years. So that's clearly, for typical providers, suppliers, this would necessarily lead to a multi-million dollar overpayment assessment. Now, luckily, though, they're not perfect. These auditors are not perfect in their statistical sampling methods and extrapolation methods, okay? And even though at the first level appeal, the redetermination, your local MAC won't even address any arguments you make trying to invalidate this process, generally at the second level, the QIC will address your arguments regarding the validity of the auditor's sampling and extrapolation method. Okay, and this is why the escalation may not necessarily be helpful. Certainly at the ALJ level, the judges will consider this. If you want, you can have professional statisticians available as witnesses to further explain why the sampling and extrapolation method employed by the auditor may be flawed, but clearly this is a growing concern, a growing trend, especially among the ZPICs, and so you need to be prepared not just to show sufficient documentation to support medical necessity, but to be able to also show why the methods that the ZPICs and other similar auditors have employed does not comply with Medicare requirements and should not be validated for overpayment purposes. Final note is recoupment. Even though you have the 120 days and 180 days and 60 days, there are some additional deadlines. And in fact, at this point, I'd like to ask my final polling question, please.
Okay, here we go. Last one, folks. Make sure you get your answers in. If your organization voluntarily refunded the overpayment while the appeal was pending, please explain the reasons. So please select one of these. You did not want to accrue interest. you did not feel confident about the chance of success. You did not know Medicare paid interest only on recouped funds. The Department of Treasury sent you collection letters, or this does not apply to you. So I'll give folks another 30 seconds or so to get their answers in. But so far the trend is pretty overwhelming. 90% of the people this hasn't applied to. And the people who it did, for the most part, did not want to accrue any interest, though we did get a couple answers in for some of the other ones. So.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. This recoupment is very peculiar. So you have the right to prevent the commencement of offsets and recoupments while your appeal is pending at certain levels. Okay? Now, the interest will accrue every 30 days. So it doesn't mean that it's interest-free suppression, but they will not offset you while accruing interest. And that interest is set by statute, and right now it's a little over 12%. It's a tremendous investment. But anyway, so for example, for the first level, you have 120 days to pursue your request for redetermination, okay? However, if you file your appeal within the first 30 days, then the local MAC will not begin recouping or offsetting based on the alleged overpayment amount, okay? Interest will accrue, but still, they will not take any money from your pending AR, all right? If that redetermination decision is unfavorable and you have to pursue the second level appeal, you have 180 days, as we discussed earlier. However, if you file the request for reconsideration within the first 60 days, then your recoupment will not begin either. Okay, so recoupment will continue to be suppressed. All right. However, after the first two levels, and you receive an unfavorable QIC decision, unfavorable reconsideration decision, there is no further way to suppress recoupment, okay? Recoupment will begin typically 30 days after the decision by the QIC is issued. This is why the delay on the scheduling of hearing is so detrimental, okay? Previously, you had 90 days to get a final decision from the judge, but now you have to wait at least a year to even have your hearing scheduled. That means recoupment will begin after the second level, and most likely be completed before the ALJ decision is issued, okay? I suppose the one good possibility is that if you prevail at the ALJ level, or any level beyond that, but let's just stick with the ALJ for simplicity purposes. If you receive a favorable ALJ decision, then all the monies that the Medicare contractor took from you will have to be returned, but also with this tremendous 12-some% interest, okay? So while you wait 2 years, the money is recouped and your interest is accruing. If you're successful at the ALJ appeal level, at the third level, all that money will be returned to you plus this interest. But it's only available, interest is only available to you if they took your money. It is not available if you actually pay the money so that you don't accrue interest, okay? Why? Because of this, you know, constitutional concept of just compensation for any government taking. Because they took the money, if they have to return it to you, they have to add interest to it. If you appear within the first 30 days, they will not recoup. If you miss that deadline, but actually still appear within the 180 days, unless you tell them to please recoup, they will also stop any recoupment that has begun. Okay, so automatically, in the first two levels of appeal, recoupment can be stopped or not even initiated, unless you tell them to recoup the money. Why would you want to tell them to recoup the money? So that at least the interest payment will decrease. Okay? Now, despite all this, you can see that now the appeal of these claims aren't solely based on medical necessity and the strength of those cases, but there's some financial implications as well. I mean, obviously, I don't think people will make decisions based on the possibility of earning interest, okay? But I think it does require an early consideration of whether or not you feel confident about your appeal. Typically, if the resources are available, I generally recommend that the money be paid. Yes, the money be paid. If you win, you'll get that back without the interest. But the possibility that if you lose, you'll be hit with that tremendous interest, I think is just too great. Okay, especially in light of the delay that's necessary for you to reach that dispositive position. So if you have resources, pay the money while you're appealing. Obviously, if you don't have resources, you have no choice, and then you have to continue to request suppression of recruitment. But know that if you prevail, ultimately, you'll get your money back plus interest only if they took your money. And if you paid voluntarily the overpayment, even if you win, you'll get your money back, but not any added interest. So this is just another wrinkle in terms of consideration of these five step appeals process. This is really for information only. If you do have specific questions regarding your organization, I'm happy to take those questions offline. But at this point, I'm happy to take on any general questions that the audience may have.
All right, so we do not have any questions that have been submitted, so if anybody's got those, go ahead and get them in the next couple of seconds. But while we're waiting, Paul, I will go ahead. Thank you for taking some time with us today to discuss this topic. I know this is something that impacts pretty much all of us that are, in healthcare, that have been impacted by this one way or another. And it's very good to understand what all of our options are when it comes to appealing these audits and these decisions. And since we don't have any questions, that's it. Thanks to everybody for attending. Be checking back on the website. We will have another webinar next month. Paul, any last-minute items to add?
No, thank everybody for your time and attention. Hopefully this will help you actually exercise your rights, because to the extent you do receive denied claims, you actually can win, but only if you actually pursue these appeals process.
All right. Thank you, Paul. Bye, everybody.